to Crypto Clothesline. We're glad to be here with you, hanging out the crypto laundry, getting all the crypto info for you. Crypto Clothesline. Crypto Clothesline.
Hello, Amy Rose.
Hi, abheeti. How you going?
I am currently sitting on the floor of my son's bedroom.
Why are you sitting on the floor?
Well, it's like this. We don't get to see the floor very often. He's got a very close relationship with floor drobes. And we haven't even learned to distinguish the dirty washing pile from the clean washing. So basically it's all one big mixed salad. So I'm just enjoying a bit of floor space after insisting that he clean his room. Now, actually, we had an early morning interview this morning and I had to dive in here like a hermit because my kids had to shuffle out the door and go to school as we were recording with the lovely Naomi Brockwell. So I'm still here on the floor.
And that was a pretty awesome interview, I must say. I'm feeling on a high because I've been wanting to interview her for so long. And yeah, getting hold of her because she's so busy, which we can relate to because we're nonstop. It's like we're on a bloody marathon 24/7. It's quite difficult to get hold of her because she is so popular and so famous and, you know, all those things.
Knowledgeable, not just fame, but brains as well. It's a pretty amazing combination.
Well, I think so too, because she must be quite strong in both her right and her left brain. So that's quite rare because she's an opera singer and then she's doing all of this technological stuff. She's quite active. So I think she's amazing.
Yeah, she's got a really interesting combination between, like you say, the right and left brain sort of hemispheres, because you've got your creative aspect, which is OTT. She's a singer, a dancer, a musician. And then you've got, like you say, that whole technological brain processing, which seems to be working on steroids. So very interesting. But how are you?
I'm pretty good. I am plugging away. You and I have a lot of projects going on in the background, which I think the podcast is our creative get to have fun side of all the projects that we have going. We also have a lot of serious stuff going on, a lot of like business stuff going on as well.
Well, I want to ask you about that in a minute, but before we do, I just want to welcome all of our listeners to the Crypto Clothesline. Our show is about helping women join the blockchain wealth revolution for themselves and for their families.
Our names are Amy Rose Goodey and abheeti-kathryn-pass, and we're speakers in blockchain and crypto, and we are on this mission.
We're learning together with you, and we certainly learned a lot from Naomi today. We're talking with leading experts in the space, and we talked to Naomi today, exploring cutting-edge technology projects, and we talked to Naomi today. Sort of shaping the future for our children, because she really does tick all those boxes, doesn't she?
She's a Bitcoin girl, by the way. This podcast is for intelligence and growth, and our values are for peace, harmony, and collaboration for the planet.
Hallelujah.
Where'd that come from?
Hallelujah. I don't know, it just came. Things come.
Beautiful. You know,
left brainers, right brainers. We're all a bit random, really. So are you ready to go public and talk to us about what's happening with the Blackboard? You've been working on this incredible project that I know about called Crypto Blackboard. You've completely revamped it. You've changed it from an online course to like basically an online meeting place for learning everything there is from where to go with crypto. Can you unpack it for us?
Yes, I can. In 2 hours, but basically it is a collaborative platform with heaps of experts from the space coming on board, choosing a topic, delivering it on the Crypto Blackboard. And it's not just crypto and blockchain. It's for entrepreneurs, startups, for children. It's for crypto, blockchain, technology, futuristic approaches. My aim is to future-proof people's careers and set them in the right direction if they're wanting to learn more about the future.
That is huge. I mean, that's got such a wide scope of sort of gift giving in the sense that it sounds like there are so many different sort of intellectual creative pursuits under that one umbrella.
There are. And I think it's definitely a work in progress. But so far, we've got 10 educators and a couple more coming on board to deliver all sorts of different courses. And it's really exciting. But what's happening with you, abheeti? You are making Fremantle the crypto city of Australia?
Something like that. We've yet to work out our tagline, but yeah, we've developed a new project. I'm working together with Sophie Amat, also another local Fremantle resident, and we have opened up a website, a temporary one for now, called wheretoshopwithcrypto.com. We've got a subsidiary of the Channel 7 News coming this afternoon, so that's another reason I'll get away from lurking in the bedroom and move into the bigger area of the house.
Yeah.
You know, can you imagine them coming in, the film and camera crew going, come into this bedroom, come into this stinky teenage hovel.
I think that'll get more views for sure.
But it's really exciting. We're speaking with a lot of collaborative partners. Well, not a lot, some key collaborative partners here. And the whole notion of that is to introduce as many retailers as possible to the idea of being able to accept Bitcoin and cryptocurrency. We feel that that is going to help massively, excuse the pun, with mass adoption. And we think that people need to be able to see Bitcoin and crypto being transacted. They need to see the stickers or the decals. They need to see that they can actually spend money here. And what is this crypto money anyway? So by introducing that point of sale software, I guess, into various shops and restaurants and boutiques and things, not only are we looking to revamp Fremantle, but we're also looking to spread the message about crypto across the board.
I'm really excited about Fremantle becoming the crypto city because it needs something. I lived in Fremantle for a while. I went back there and I was like, it feels slightly dead. I feel like the merchants there, they need people to come through their doors. And if that's travelers, which Frio has heaps and heaps of coming through, then why not implement a payment system that travelers want to use, which is cryptocurrency? You can use it all over the world.
Well, that's part of it. You see, Fremantle attracts a lot of millennials, and I've been doing my research on this because we've been doing some meetups and doing some presentations. So, of course, I had to put a deck together. And I think millennials make up, between international and domestic travelers, millennials make up well over 30% of the average of people that either visit Fremantle or stay in Fremantle. And if you think about the fact that millennials are born pretty much crypto ready, I mean, that's a generalization, but for a millennial, it's a no-brainer to have a wallet on your phone and to be able to scan something. Perhaps for a baby boomer or even Gen X like me, it's a little bit more challenging to sort of get your head around that. So it is pretty exciting. And the other thing about Frio that we're keen to do is to transform it into more of a technical hub. So have some more blockchain events there, you know, create a bit more of a thriving buzz. So, I mean, that's happening on your side of the world, isn't it? You were just telling me before that there's all sorts of extremely exciting events related to blockchain and crypto happening on the Sunshine Coast and Brisbane.
Yeah, and we will be reporting from these events and we'll be media partners for one of them as well. But it is happening over here, but it's happening in WA as well. I feel like they're just mirroring each other. So it's great. I think it's great for the whole country. And in the interview with Naomi, we talked about how New York used to be the leader, or the US used to be the leader, but then she's also from WA. So she talked about how Australia is leading the way, how we're doing things over here that no one else in the world is actually doing. And it's really awesome, firstly, that we live in Australia. How beautiful is it? And secondly, we're like perhaps the crypto country of the world. Just putting it out there.
I heard a statistic the other day, I can't remember where, so I don't have much qualification behind this, but that we were number three on the world scale of countries involved in blockchain, you know, technological development. So I do believe that, you know, China is just forging ahead and leaving us all behind. That's a concern that was raised. Sort of the blockchain development and the projects that are happening over there are absolutely leaving the rest of the world behind. I don't like the saying leaving us for dead because I just don't like it. I'm not going to use it. But it's such an important thing to be active in this space and not just taking it for granted, not just letting other people work out all the great ideas. As Naomi says in the interview, it's updating itself every 2 minutes. And even if you're doing stuff full time, you can never keep on top of all the information that's being thrown out there.
Absolutely. And it's a long race as well. Yeah, perhaps China's doing pretty well. They love their little mining pools. Pretty big fans of mining the crap out of Bitcoin in China. But everything has its time. I'm just imagining the Melbourne Cup and all the horses racing. A very long race. This isn't a 5 minute thing. Some people say 25 years, like Kieran Mosqueda, and Naomi said 10. So we'll see.
Yeah, Kieran Mosqueda said we've been in it 10 years, therefore another 15. Oh, so right. A 25 year total. And he talked about that being like the life cycle of the internet. So,
God. I was thinking another 25 years. Jesus, that depressed
me. No. We'll still be alive to enjoy it.
Before we go into the interview, we need to let you know that we are user supported. We're providing quality and fun content for you, just like Andreas Antonopoulos. So please support us on Patreon. You can find those details in the show notes.
Let's listen to the interview with Naomi. And I need to let listeners know you must listen to the end because the juiciest of juicy bits comes right at the end.
Thank you so much, Naomi Brockwell, for joining us on Crypto Clothesline. For all of the listeners, we are talking today with Bitcoin Girl, who is a little bit of a hero, and we are so honored to have you on the show. I'm a little bit starstruck, so don't mind me.
Thank you so much for having me. It's great to be here.
No, it's so exciting to have you here. I'm really thrilled because I've been doing just a wee bit of stalking. I first heard about you when you came over here recently and an American friend of mine said, oh my gosh, Bitcoin Girl was here. Why weren't you here? She's from Perth. And I was like, oh my gosh, I had no idea. Like it wasn't particularly well advertised that you were coming over. Had I known that this was such an auspicious occasion, I definitely would have come down to meet you.
No, it was really fun. I got back over to Perth in April and we had a meetup there, just crypto meetup. And it's what's so awesome is to have seen crypto bloom so much in Australia over the past few years. Like I remember going back home and telling people what I was doing in America and everyone would be like, what? What is this thing you're talking about? And now, like recent years, I go back and my grandmother in particular would start to like, every time I call home, she'd be telling me like Bitcoin price movements and like, oh, you know, it's very popular in China at the moment and tell me all this stuff. She's 93. It was absolutely gobsmacking to see it just kind of bloom so quickly. And so I'm really thrilled to see what's going on in Australia at the moment.
It is. It's a really thriving community. It's developing in leaps and bounds.
So can you, Naomi, tell us, how does it differ over from New York to Australia? Australia has come up. I mean, there's a lot of merchants now accepting crypto. And I know in the past, I heard some of your previous interviews years ago, and you said that you prefer New York for one of the reasons is it's very crypto friendly in the US and compared to over here. But now that it's becoming more accepted here, particularly with the travel by bit and a lot of point of sale systems being outlaid at the moment, how are the two spaces different now?
Well, I would say that New York is one of the worst places in the world for crypto at the moment.
Really?
Yeah, absolutely. So what happened over here in 2014 was they had what was called the Bitcoin hearings, and I covered them with Reason. I reported in a couple of pieces about them, where they were trying to figure out, okay, there's this new thing called Bitcoin. How do we regulate it? How do we deal with this thing that seems to be taking a lot of power away from banks, a lot of power away from like Federal Reserve and all these things? And so they were quite worried about it. So they had these hearings, and a man by the name of Ben Lorsky put together this legislation that basically brought crypto and blockchain companies to a halt in New York, the BIT license. It's been absolutely devastating to the industry here. Like as soon as the BIT license was announced, every company left New York. You know, you had Kraken leave, you had Shapeshift not serving New York customers anymore. And since then, in all of those years, I think they've issued 8 BIT licenses. And one of the licenses was issued to a company that this legislator actually works on the board of now. So it's this very kind of corrupt bureaucratic system here that makes it very unfriendly to cryptocurrency businesses. It's so sad to see because back in the day, I mean, it was called Crypto Alley, you know. You had Silicon Valley and Silicon Alley over here, and then you had all these blockchain companies set up. We had right on Wall Street, actually, we had the New York Bitcoin Center for years, and we were thinking, oh my gosh, this is going to be the new center of the world. This is about rebalancing power. People were really excited, and then this legislation came in and basically killed everything off. So New York is not a crypto-friendly place right now, and because of that, you've seen other cities really pick up the slack, like places like Wyoming, where the legislation that they introduced is so crypto-friendly. I wouldn't be surprised if a lot of businesses start incorporating there for cryptocurrency. Different places around the world, I mean, look at Malta right now. Gibraltar's really trying to be a Bitcoin hub. And so it's really to New York's own detriment that they made it so difficult for businesses here because this industry isn't going to come to a halt. It's just going to move. It's just going to find a place that is more crypto-friendly. That's exactly what's happening right now. Like you look at the Australian government, for example, they're looking at replacing, I think it's called the CHESS system in Australia. Here it's a SWIFT system. The way the funds are cleared, they're thinking of replacing that with blockchain tech. And that's just been pushed back to, I think, 2022. That seems leaps and bounds ahead of what the rest of the world are doing right now. The fact that the government has enough foresight to recognize the power of this tech and actually explore it is kind of interesting.
It's a really interesting point because I was reading an article that Centrelink, the social security payment system, for listeners that are not familiar with it, people with disabilities sending out their payments using blockchain.
Yeah, no, I think it's definitely going to be a rebalancing of our financial systems. I mean, as the technology develops, we've really only just started to see the very tip of what's possible with this tech. I chatted to Scott Stornetta a couple of months ago, who really has the idea that cryptocurrency is such an amazing application of blockchain tech, but it really is just one application. And what we've learned to do is to decentralize trust. And the number of industries that this can be applied to is just, I mean, we can't even comprehend it. So I'm really excited about the next 10 years to see what's going to be happening as we learn to decentralize trust across all kinds of different organizational structures, or corporations, governmental structures, financial institutions. I think it's going to be a really exciting time.
It's interesting that you spoke to Scott Stornetta because we had Kieran on recently, Kieran Mesquita.
I love Kieran.
Yeah, I've seen him on some of your crypto quiz shows.
We were actually just in New Zealand together. So I emceed Blockchain South down there last week. And that was a whole heap of fun. New Zealand is another very interesting place. You know, on the one hand, they have some strange regulation with regards to like handing over devices and having to give your passwords. It makes me a bit uneasy. But on the other hand, it seems very crypto friendly and they're, you know, trying their best to set up regulation in a way that makes it possible for the tech to bloom rather than to kind of hinder it.
Yeah, it's a very interesting thing. I've not looked into New Zealand per se, but there was a lot of coverage of their sort of invasion of privacy crossing the border and sort of wanting to see into people's phones and things. It got a very bad.
Well, Australia as well, the talk about the encryption backdoors is terrifying. And that's going to be an enabler to countries all over the world. I mean, you're going to have the UK and the USA and Canada, like all other countries, they're going to be piggybacking on the loophole. I mean, these backdoors that Australia is setting up. So that worries me tremendously. And so it's kind of like this, you know, left hand not talking to the right hand. Some parts of the government are really like, yes, this is the future. Let's embrace this. Let's create prosperity and jobs and create more efficient companies. And the other side of things, they're kind of doing things to limit people and invade privacy. It's a strange time.
Naomi, you recently announced on Twitter, and your Twitter is really awesome. It's like buzzing all the time for all the listeners. Check it out. But you've also recently cracked, I think, 6,000 subscribers on YouTube.
I started my channel like full time at the start of this year. So it's super exciting to see it grow so fast. Before that, I was a producer for John Stossel. And I think listeners in Australia probably don't know John, but he's been a huge mentor for me. He's won like 19 Emmys. He's an amazing journalist over here in the States. So I've been really, really lucky. I still work for him part time. But yeah, this start of this year, I just thought, no, I'm just going to focus on tech and particularly blockchain tech. I'd made feature films about it in the past and they'd done well. And I've made like fun music videos and interviews. But this year I was like, I need to be covering this full time because the space moves so fast. There's so much going on that it's just not enough for me to sporadically kind of report on what's going on. This requires like in-depth coverage of the space. And it's been so rewarding for me, just like the friends that I've made and people's response to the channel as well. Like a lot of new people coming in who can feel overwhelmed by, I don't really understand cryptocurrency. I don't really understand Bitcoin, you know, and to have like something that's more accessible to them. I've gotten a lot of good feedback about that. So yeah, really happy about that.
But Naomi, winding back a little bit from WA, as you are, Western Australia, how did a WA girl end up living in New York, covering all these amazing things? I had a little look into your background from actress to musician and dancer, co-founder of the Sohome Forum, the monthly debates on libertarian topics, emceeing events, Bitcoin girl, YouTube channel. What's going on?
Let's just round of applause. I'm going to put that in there.
You're a superwoman. I mean, I knew about you, but when I started to sort of really do some heavy duty stalking, I was like, whoa, when does this girl sleep?
It's been pretty fun. I actually started out in Australia. I was studying economics at UWA and hated it. It was like the most dry, boring thing in the world. So then I did two performance degrees. So I did a degree in acting and then I did a degree in classical music. And I was at WAPA there, actually. That's where I did my degree in classical music. But I continued my studies over in New York. I came over to New York just so that I could pursue opera full time. I was really, really into opera at the time and didn't plan on moving here. But then I came over and the training was amazing. This is like the opera center of the world. And so I just kind of stayed. And then I actually became friends with the economics editor of Barron's, Gene Epstein, who took me under his wing. And to go full circle, I became obsessed with Austrian economics.
That's random.
Yeah, really random. And that's what got me into crypto as well. So just the idea of competing currencies and, you know, the freedom to be away from like a centralized banking system. So I got really interested in cryptocurrency and tech in general and sort of progressed from there. Gave up singing, became a film producer and really started focusing on the blockchain world.
That really shows an incredible flexibility of mind to be able to jump from all these different disciplines and, you know, to go into them quite deeply and then go right next, because it shows that natural evolution. You know how people just think, okay, I'm a pilot, I'm going to be a pilot all my life. And that's great if that's what people are into. But I love the way that your life, you know, from an outside perspective has weaved and changed and become such a mosaic, you know, such a tapestry, as Noah Klein would call it.
Like opera singing. Oh, the natural segue is cryptocurrency. No, it's been super fun. And yeah, so Gene and I actually set up the Soho Forum here and that's been tremendously successful. There's a debate that he runs every month now about different issues. They talk about foreign policy, talk about different things in the Bill of Rights here over in America, civil liberties, all kinds of things. So it's been a really fun series to be a part of.
Wow.
And Naomi, we recently interviewed, as you know, Kira Mosqueda. You mentioned 10 years of timeline for adoption. I don't know if that was your exact words, but you mentioned 10 years. In our interview with Kieran, he said 25 years before we see true mass adoption. Your ideas vary a little bit. How long do you think? I mean, 10 years is a good sort of ballpark. I'm worried about that because I thought it was going to be sooner. But how long do you think and what things need to happen to see this mass adoption?
Kieran's one of the smartest people that I know. I'm more likely to defer to him. But from my perspective, I've just seen things go so fast in even just the last 2 years. I think that there are so many organizations that now have blockchain departments, you know, giant organizations like IBM or whether they're the big banks here in the US who are exploring this. I just think that where I think Bitcoin's a bit antithetical to, they're exploring it and trying to see how is this a way that could benefit our organization. I think the blockchain is eventually going to be pervasive and we won't even notice, like people won't know that blockchain is being implemented. Like there's so many protocols in our everyday life, especially in our digital existence that are happening under the hood that, you know, we don't even know what the base layers of this tech is based on. But I think that's going to be blockchain and it's going to be working in a lot of different things, a lot of different organizations that we deal with at the moment, and we won't even know that it's happening. And I think that's already started. So how long it takes for that to really, you know, shoot off, anyone's guesses is going to be just a guess. There's no way of knowing and no way of like making price predictions, no way of really guessing with this tech. But from my perspective, it really is a true revolution. You know, if you think about how much of our lives today we're living in the digital world, it's so much of it, whether it's from emails, or social media, to photos. And to now suddenly have a tool where we've learned how to make digital assets irreproducible, that's a real game changer for our digital lives. And I just think we're going to see more and more use of that from different organizations, different reward systems, maybe decentralization of data control. You're not going to see a lot of companies be able to access our data or to benefit off our data. I think that profit is eventually going to be distributed back to the user. We're going to figure out mechanisms for doing that. So there are a lot of different structures that I think are going to be changing. And we've already started to see the change. I think the change in 10 years is going to be really huge. In 25 years, I don't even like to make predictions about what's going to happen in 2 years.
Yeah.
Very volatile space. So does that mean there will be no more Pakistani phone calls at 6 p.m. when you're serving dinner?
Oh, we will always have those. And they know exactly when to call. It's always when you sit down to dinner. They've got it perfect.
I think they might have handballed across to the Philippines now because they're so sweet, those people. They go, oh, hello, are you Mrs. Pass? And that's when I know I've got to hang up.
Yeah, exactly.
Unidentified calling object. I'm off. I'm gone.
Unidentified calling object. I like it.
So I was really interested, like, you know, the whole Bitcoin girl spoof. I bet Billy Joel did nicely out of that. That kind of would have revived his record set. But can you tell me how that all came to be? It looks very playful. It's clearly a spoof on his Uptown Girl hit from the 80s, I seem to think it was. And how was that received in the industry? People see that as you sort of taking the mickey, or did they think it was fun? How was that taken?
Well, at the time, I was actually working at the New York Bitcoin Center. The opening of the video was filmed there, actually. So when I walk in the door, that's James Spanos that I high-five as the brother of the owner of the center. Actually, one of the guys there then went on to work at Kraken. It's fascinating back then to have all these people involved who then went on to work in different areas of the industry. That's been a lot of fun. But I was actually making videos under the moniker of Bitcoin Girl, basically because the name wasn't taken. You had all of these people, like you had Libertarian Girl and Objectivist Girl. You had all of these names that seemed to be a fad back in like 2013. And Bitcoin Girl wasn't a thing. So I claimed that. I started making videos and made a bunch of videos in Bitcoin Center in New York. And that sort of grew. And then I thought it would be fun to do a Bitcoin Girl cover. And the organization I was working with at the time is like an artistic organization. So they said, all right, we'll get behind that. And so between us, we put together this thing and I edited it all together and recorded the song and put this out. And it was received really well. Like I had my Bitcoin address in there for donations from the industry and was really, really surprised with how much support I got for that. It was such a small space at the time. And people were just overjoyed that there was someone who was making something fun in crypto in a time when the mainstream media were only talking about, you know, people who are interested in who are buying drugs and who were interested in money laundering. And it was all this very negative perspective on cryptocurrency in general. And so to have someone coming and say, actually, this is really fun and exciting and playful, and we should be excited about this, not scared of it. I think people were very appreciative of that.
Especially when you bought the hot dog or the water from the guy at the hot dog stand. I thought that was a scream with a QR code, you know, big cheesy grin.
Yeah, I filmed that. That was right down on Wall Street there. So it was actually pretty fun being right in the center of the traditional financial world. And then there was a scene at the old Mac store on Fifth Avenue and between the Mac store and Tiffany's. So it had like a kind of hat tip to the Marilyn Monroe, you know, the scene where they offer her like the diamond necklaces and things. It was pretty fun. At one stage, someone offers me like a Paul Krugman book and I push it away in disgust. It's actually kind of funny, like the hidden things in that video. I should go back and do like a behind the scenes talk about it because there are lots of things, yeah, that I kind of pushed in there. Like she goes and the guy tries to buy a Fiat car, like the computer blows up. And I go and buy a Tesla because at the time you could buy Teslas for Bitcoin. They accepted it directly. You know, one of my friends was wearing like a Frycat t-shirt who was like a person in the space at the time. So it's kind of fun having all these inside jokes that I think no one got.
Yeah, you could do some sort of academic paper called, you know, The Deeper Side of Bitcoin Girl or something like that.
Absolutely.
Here's some fun trivia. We have a lot of male listeners. A lot of these male listeners have told us that they're trying to get their wives to listen because at the end of the day, it's the women that make all the financial decisions in the house. They go to their wives and they say, so I want to buy some of this crypto stuff. And the wives turn around and they're like, no, don't do it. I've been watching Channel 9 and they've said, don't buy crypto.
Channel 9, you must listen to them.
Yeah. Or like, I read in the newspaper, don't do it. It's like massive drug money and money laundering thing. But like, you've been in the space for ages. You've been a woman in the space since day dot. Have you got any words of wisdom for women who are like not wanting to get involved because they don't buy crack with it?
Maybe that women can be more risk averse, especially if they're mothers, you know, they have a family to hold together and they are in charge of financial decisions. I totally understand that people wouldn't want to get into a currency that's risky. And I would say that's fine. That's totally great. And whenever any of my friends ask me like, oh, should I buy into this? I say, listen, if you're going to get into this, you need to only invest an amount that you're willing to lose because no one knows what's going to happen. It's incredibly volatile. It's a huge risk. And we can't just, you know, brush over that fact. I can't be convincing people like, oh, well, you should get into it anyway. You're missing out on a huge opportunity. Like that's absolutely not my call to make. But what I will stress is you cannot invest more than you're willing to lose because it's still really early days with this stuff and no one really knows what's going to happen. And people need to be responsible for the risks that they're taking. So when I was back in Australia, I went to a friend's game night and I met a friend of mine there who said, oh, Naomi, oh, you're like into this Bitcoin stuff. One of my friends is here. Her husband's really into that. You two should chat. And I was getting really excited. I was like, oh, finally, you know, someone at this game night I can chat crypto with. So I go up to her and I'm like, oh, I hear that, you know, your husband's into crypto. And she goes, yeah, and it's so boring. I was like,
okay. My god.
My heart just sank. It's definitely not for everyone. You know, I have some kick-ass female friends who are just dominating the space and being awesome. Kick-ass male friends who are dominating. It really comes down to personal interests and personal tastes for risk. Mm. And definitely not ever going to try and push someone or encourage them to say like, oh, we'll give it a go even though it's risky because it really is such a personal decision. And people need to be careful in this space. A lot of scam artists out there. The technology is very new. You know, there are always security issues being worked out. As they're worked out, the system becomes stronger, more robust, that's for sure. But at the same time, there is still a huge risk involved. So just be careful out there.
I think it's a really good point that you made also in terms of the risk factor. But I think there's an assumption that you've got to buy an entire Bitcoin or that you need $100,000.
Yeah, it's too expensive. I can't afford $6,517. It's like, oh, no. Okay, so, you know, in the same way that dollars, you know, there's decimal place, there are only two decimal places with dollar. You have, you know, cents and it goes down to like 1 cent and there are 100 cents in a dollar, you know. For Bitcoin, one Satoshi is the smallest decimal place. And I think that's like 0.000001. I don't know if I got the right number of zeros there. But it's like really, really divisible. So you definitely don't need to be buying a whole Bitcoin. You could buy a Satoshi if you wanted to.
Yeah, if you've got $20 left over from the family budget, instead of going buying three coffees, which is pretty much what it'll cost you, $20 anywhere in Fremantle, you know, you go and grab yourself $20 worth of Bitcoin and just sit on it and forget about it. The same way as if you drank a coffee, you forget about that and you're getting zero return on paying that money.
But, yeah,
you
know, I think that's such a good point. And I do encourage people to do that. Like if they're not living hand to mouth and that $20 is really important to them that month, sure, you know, have a play, test it out because it's an exciting world. And once you start researching into this tech, it gets really exciting what's going on. So for sure, if you can afford, you know, a few dollars just to spend and play and actually feel what it's like to purchase on one of these exchanges or one of these platforms, it can be really rewarding and exciting as well.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm interested to ask you, as Amy Rose mentioned, you've been in the space for a very long time. You're a bit of a pioneer, especially us women. What is for you the absolute favorite part of being in the crypto and blockchain space?
Oh, the people, for sure. I'm really lucky I get to MC about 20 blockchain conferences a year all over the world. And so I get this sort of ear to the ground perspective where I'm hearing people pitch all the time. I'm hearing these new projects that are being launched and I get to kind of keep up with what's going. And I feel like I'm constantly running to catch up. I work in this space full time. I should be up to date with what's going on and I never am. I'll go to a conference and someone will announce a new way that they're applying the tech and I'm like, whoa, they're doing that now? Like, when did this happen? And it's just a constant game of catch up. You know, you're surrounded by the smartest minds in the world who are just working on this groundbreaking new technology, applying it to all these different industries. We don't really know what the potential is yet. And so for me, just meeting those people, getting their perspective, finding out what it's like in different countries as well. Different cultures have a very different relationship with cryptocurrency. You know, for people in Venezuela, it's a lifeline for them. For people in America who got in the early days, it was kind of like a stand for freedom. You know, people in Eastern Europe, it might be because a lot of them had come from like very corrupt governments and they want an alternative system. So it's just fascinating to see all these different perspectives all over the world and to meet all these really great people. So that's definitely my favorite part about all of it.
Yeah, that's an awesome answer. Amy Rose and I have often looked at each other and said, which other community can you meet a complete stranger and strike up the most sort of fascinating of conversations? And there's a lot of inclusion. I mean, yes, there's a bit of elbow pushing, and yes, there's a bit of sort of competitive nature, and yes, it's around money. So sometimes people can get a little protective of their IP, you know, their information. But in reality, there's such a lot of absolute community-based sharing of information, promoting each other's work, you know, cross-pollination. It's a really thriving place to be.
That's a great point you raise about just having that instant relationship. I mean, if you're lining up for a Bitcoin ATM, you can bet that you'll be able to strike up a conversation with that stranger and have the most wonderful conversation. You'll both kind of get it. If you start chatting to people as you're lining up for a normal like Chase ATM or Bankwest ATM, like, I mean, you'll probably get hauled away by security guard. It's not going to be pleasant for anyone. But there is this sort of instant brotherhood that happens, or sisterhood, or whatever you want to call it, this camaraderie that happens when you meet people who understand this tech, and you meet them and it's like, oh, you get it. You know, we have things to talk about. We have things in common. We believe in the future. That's been wonderful. I've made some of the most amazing friends all over the world that I'm eternally grateful for every day.
I remember when I was living in Italy, I had this little dog, right? I found her on the street. So she was a foundling. She used to eat rubbish. She was a nightmare, to be honest. But whenever I would take her for a walk, all these people would talk to me. And I realized that having a dog was a people magnet. You actually got to meet people in the community because you had a dog. Now I'm thinking what we could do is walk around going, I love Bitcoin, or have a big t-shirt, and then we could talk to people.
You know what? That actually happens. So my sister was doing yoga in Australia, and there was this guy who was wearing this blockchain t-shirt at every yoga session. And so in the end, like, she became friends with him, started talking about him, and then she ended up introducing us. So now I have this new friend in Australia who's absolutely wonderful that I connected with only because my sister met him because he was wearing a blockchain t-shirt.
We all need to dress up. Blockchain, Bitcoin, make friends.
But I was catching a train to join Amy Rose at Block Conscious in Brisbane earlier this year. I flew across from Perth, and there was a guy in front of me with a blockchain t-shirt. And I went, oh my gosh, there's another one. And I said to him, oh, are you going to Block Conscious too? And he went, nah, I got this off a mate in a hotel in London.
Oh my God.
Were you really disappointed?
It was a conversation starter, as my mother would say.
Awesome. Before we go, there's one question that we do ask. Do you have a favorite quote that you go by?
Oh, gosh, that's a really tough question. You kind of put me on the spot here. I got a lot of great quotes. When I first moved to New York and I said I became friends with the economics editor of Barron's, we started this Austrian economics reading group where we'd just be reading awesome economics texts from Hayek and Mises and Rothbard. And so I know that those ones are filled with quotes. I remember that Hayek gave an interview where he basically predicted cryptocurrencies. He was saying, yes, first of all, we need to get a new form of money, and it's likely that we'll never get back on the gold standard, and we need to find an alternative. And that alternative is going to come around in some sly roundabout way that the government doesn't notice, and everyone's going to start using it, and soon it's going to be too hard to stop. Like, it's a quote, something like that. That was the essence of it. And I just thought, wow, that's so profound and such a great representation of Bitcoin, which kind of came from this beautiful organic grassroots movement of people just finding this new tool so valuable and sharing it with each other. And the evangelists, you know, in the space who would go out of their way every taxi ride they take, they'd introduce their taxi driver to it and say, hey, do you want me to tip you in Bitcoin? You know, they go to the hairdresser, hey, do you want me to tip you in Bitcoin? They'd go out for a meal and tell the waiter, hey, can I set you up with a Bitcoin account? And that sort of organic growth of just people saying, I found something valuable, let me share it with you, and I think we'll all benefit, I think is so beautiful. I just love that quote, and I just love that what ended up happening with Bitcoin and this beautiful movement.
And who said that? And where was it?
It was Hayek, and it was in an interview in, was it 1980? It's actually on my YouTube channel, so let me pull it up. Hayek.
Because we might just play a little bit of that. That'll be cool to put in the interview.
That would be awesome, yeah.
Okay, he says, I don't believe, and the whole interview is great. So this is from a 1989 interview that he did. And he says, I don't believe we shall ever have a good money again before we take the thing out of the hands of government. We can't take it out violently out of the hands of government. All we can do is by some sly roundabout way, introduce something that they can't stop.
Oh my God.
I think that's such a great quote. I really love it.
Do you think, Naomi, that in order for Bitcoin and crypto to become mainstream and to sort of slide out of the echelons of, you know, the super geeks and, you know, big business and banks and all the people that are amassing crypto wealth while the rest of the population is dozing off, what do you think we need to do in order to make that happen? Help people set up Bitcoin wallets? Show people about this stuff?
I don't think it's ever going to happen with people being interested, because everyone has to make choices in their life about what they're going to specialize in, what they're going to be interested in. We all had to pick our battles. It's not likely that people are going to be like, oh, I'm going to be really interested in finding an alternative to this credit card I'm using that is so simple. Everyone has a system that kind of works, right? If you come from a country like Australia or America, the financial system, you may hate it, but it works. And people can just use their bank card. And honestly, it's a huge ask to say, go and explore this alternative, use this more cumbersome system that's harder to use. You know, teaching people that financial freedom is important is really difficult. And I don't know that that's ever something that's going to be successful at. That being said, this technology is going to change the underpinnings of everything we do on the internet, everything we do in our digital lives. So there's going to be a mainstream adoption of this that just happens without people realizing it happening. And it's going to come from the people who believed in the tech to start off with, the ones who are pushing this, who are implementing it, who are putting that tech, working it into existing companies and new payment systems. And I think that that's what's going to end up happening. It's not going to be something we're aware of or that the average person is aware of. It's just going to be something that slowly evolves to the point where everyone is just kind of using this.
All right. I wanted to put you on the spot. I was wondering if you could do one paragraph or one part of Bitcoin Girl in an operatic way.
Oh my God. That's such... Oh, wow. In an operatic way.
Like that's Bitcoin Girl.
You have put me on the spot. I've got some new songs. I've started doing a weekly song challenge where a friend of mine rewrites a song about cryptocurrency. They've been so dumb. There have been some ridiculous ones, like My Favorite Coins Hero from The Sound of Music.
Oh, do it. Come on.
All right. Airdrops of tokens and ICO listings. Two-factor verify, cold wallet linking. Telegram groups online that you can join. And here are a few of my favorite coins. And then it goes on to like talk about all these coins. Like steam it for post-it and pull it for rhyming. Red coin is smart cash for personal tithing. Also with Dash, Monero and Dogecoin. These are a few of my favorite coins. It's just like it's verses and verses of all the different cryptos.
Oh,
so if
funny.
You like silly things, then feel free to check that out.
Oh my God, I just love that so much. I could listen to that whole song.
Well, thank you so much for joining us, Naomi. It's been an absolute pleasure. I'm sorry that I was busting to get here. I was a little bit late, but you know, we do what we can across time zones.
Absolutely. It's been so wonderful chatting with you both. Thanks so much for having me on.
Thanks, Naomi.
And please look us up when you come back to Australia.
Of course, yes. Maybe we could do like an in-person podcast.
Oh, too much fun.
It'll be brutal.
All right. Thanks so much, guys.
Lots of love.
Thank you, Naomi. Bye.
Bye.
All right. Well, that's got to be the funnest interview we've had so far, don't you think?
I do love a little bit of opera. Or you might call it Oprah. I don't know how you're going to put it, but I don't mind. And how good was that?
Yeah, I've still got Julie Andrews pumping through my brain. She has such a sweet voice. I mean, you could really hear the use of the breath and controlling the breath in the way we just put her on the spot, totally.
I had a WTF moment. I didn't know what was happening. Yeah. Like, you're like, can you do this? I'm like, this is going to be cool. I didn't know Abheeti was going to pop this out of her hood, but here we go.
Yeah, as we said in the intro, I was just so impressed by Naomi's incredible wealth of information. She just really packs a punch in the most positive sense of the phrase, like information, such a lot of information sharing within a short 35-minute interview.
I think what everyone needs to do is jump on her YouTube channel if you want to be thoroughly entertained, and also her other social media platforms as well. I was watching, I think it might have been her Instagram, and she was doing a dance with her sister on a treadmill, I think it was. Either way, she does some really funny stuff. I think she tries to make sure that it's not boring.
What I really liked about her was that she provides absolutely high-level technical information in a quirky, upbeat kind of a way. She's got this mix between actor and sort of almost comedian, but she's talking with these tech heads. She's talking, you know, like that quiz show. It's just a complete trip. I love the way she presents technical information in a really quirky and groovy way. She's got personal branding, which is very 50s, which is very, you know, upbeat and groovy. But she's also able to sort of encapsulate so much information around the blockchain and the cryptocurrency world in a serious reporter style way. It's a really interesting combo that she's got going on, a fabulous package.
I think what might have to happen is we have like a catch up drink session. Oh, we should invite her to our next party.
Oh, my Lord, that would just be so funny. Well, she talked about doing a live podcast. I mean, I love the sound of that, but I want to do something live visually. That would just be too funny, just too funny.
I would love that too. And I think she does come to Australia. She's a WA girl, so, I mean, there's no reason why you two can't catch up for a sparkly or a coffee. I'm a bit jealous. I'm going to come over too. Stuff it.
Will you be my friend?
Find out when she's coming and be like, oh, this is weird. We're on the same plane. This is, oh, hi. Want to hang out with me?
You just fly yourself to New York so you can fly from New York to Perth. That's a fabulous idea.
Exactly.
New York flights come to the eastern states first, so you can just jump on board in Sydney. Fabulous.
Oh, my God.
You girls can cause a ruckus on the plane.
Oh, man. This is what happens when two ladies get together to stalk someone.
Before we wrap up, we wanted to mention to you again, we are user-supported, just like Andreas Antonopoulos. We hope that you've really enjoyed this interview with Naomi Brockwell, Bitcoin Girl, including her fabulous little song at the end. Please support us on Patreon. There's a link in the show.
Hi, you've called Abheeti.
And Amy Rose.
At Crypto.
Clothesline.
Leave a message after the
beep.
Okay, 3, 2, 1.
Ready?
Now, this idea that you had with this fella called Stevie Giassi from Legal Aid, something about legal stuff on the blockchain, sounds to me like some more palaver, which is not really worth the time of day to listen to. But, you know, honestly, people, our legal system is robust. It is fabulous. We've had it since the days of the convicts, and it certainly served us well. I mean, look at us. We're all living in this wonderful country, and we wouldn't be here if it weren't for those convicts and for the legal system that whacked all those people on the boats in the first place in the middle of the harbour in London. So, do you know, people, just get a grip. Crypto Clothesline.